Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Coming up on the program, I report on President Joe Biden's executive order on artificial intelligence. Joe Robbins has a story on the deal made between striking autoworkers and General Motors. Dan Friedell reports on the British Museum's plans to make digital copies of all the objects it keeps. Next, Gregory Stockel has this week's health and lifestyle report on a study that shows AI tools used in healthcare could cause harm to patients. Later, Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins present the lesson of the day. But first, U.S. President Joe Biden has issued an executive order related to artificial intelligence. Biden signed the order on Monday. He said the government needs to move quickly to work with companies developing artificial intelligence, or AI, technology. Jeff Zients, Biden's chief of staff, said the president once said, "We can't move at the normal government pace." Biden signed an executive order that requires technology companies working on AI projects to develop rules to protect consumers. An executive order permits the president to tell a U.S. government agency how to act on an issue that lawmakers have not yet dealt with. In the order, Biden said he is using the Defense Production Act, which permits the government, under some conditions, to direct the activities of private businesses. By signing the order, Biden is moving ahead of the U.S. Congress. The executive order goes past voluntary agreements made by companies such as Meta and Google to make AI technology safer for regular people. The new order requires technology companies that want to use AI in applications for security, the economy, public health, and safety to share information with the U.S. government. The National Institute of Standards and Technology will work to create tests that new AI tools must pass before they are released to the public. The U.S. government will be required to think about how AI will be used in cybersecurity, the supervision of chemicals, radiation, and nuclear materials. The order tells the Department of Commerce to create guidelines for materials generated by AI. That means something such as a photo or video needs to have a mark or stamp showing that AI technology was used to create it. One version of this is called a watermark. In the case of a photo, a watermark would be a small sign showing that a computer created the image. The order says it aims to deal with concerns that AI will only help certain people. It requires any use of AI technology to follow civil rights guidelines designed to prevent discrimination in hiring, housing, medical treatments, and the sentencing of criminals. Biden said he would direct the Department of Justice to bring charges over civil rights violations related to AI technology. Biden's declaration covers the use of AI by schools, students, and businesses. One section says companies that want to use AI tools must also consider the harms and maximize the benefits of AI for workers. Biden's advisors called the order the strongest set of actions any government has taken to ensure AI security. Bruce Reed is the White House Deputy Chief of Staff. He said the order is an aggressive strategy. A Biden administration official also said the president plans to ask U.S. lawmakers to push for stronger data privacy protections. Biden said he wants the U.S. government to stay ahead of AI technology instead of falling behind as it did when social media companies like Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram began to get popular. Biden said he is concerned about the way artificial intelligence can create false images, sounds, and videos. The images, he said, can hurt the way people see themselves, spread false information, and permit criminals to do harm. One example, he noted, is that AI can recreate a person's voice. Criminals can then use the sound of a person's voice to make a false call to a friend or family member. However, he said he sees the possible good things that can come from the new technology to solve medical problems and improve government services. Government officials around the world say they are worried about the use of AI. The Group of Seven released a document on Monday saying plans are in place for a code of conduct agreement that will apply to companies developing artificial intelligence systems.
The United Auto Workers, or UAW, reached a tentative agreement with General Motors on Monday. The agreement, once approved by UAW members, will end the 6-week work stoppage affecting the 3 biggest U.S. car makers. The Associated Press reported that GM Chief Mary Barra met with UAW leaders over the weekend and Monday morning to close the deal. The agreement follows similar deals the labor union reached in the last few days with Ford and Stellantis, the maker of Chrysler and Jeep. All 3 companies agreed to raise pay by 25% for top workers. People who are familiar with the agreement say that additional cost of living adjustments would bring their total pay increases to over 30%. At Stellantis, top workers now make around $31 an hour. Under the new deal, that will go up to more than $42 an hour. Nearly 50,000 auto workers out of nearly 150,000 union members at the 3 automakers joined the strike that began on September 15th. The deals are seen as a victory for workers who had given up raises following the 2008 financial crisis to help the companies. UAW leaders argued that their contract fight was part of a much larger movement to make up for years of economic setbacks for American workers. This is more than an auto industry story. It is a signal to the entire country that unionized workers can demand and get big wage increases, said Patrick Anderson of the Anderson Economic Group. U.S. President Joe Biden on Monday praised the tentative agreement. "I think it's great," he said. Biden had earlier joined striking workers at a General Motors parts center west of Detroit, Michigan. Biden's action represented the strongest ever presidential support for striking workers in a labor dispute. Aides to Biden have been worried about a lengthy auto strike and drop in production. They were concerned that it would damage both the U.S. economy and the Democratic president's chances of re-election in 2024. The 3 automakers argued that the UAW's demands would greatly raise costs and put them in competition with non-union car makers like America's Tesla and Japan's Toyota. The UAW said before the GM announcement that it wants to expand negotiations to other non-union car makers in 2028. University of Michigan professor Eric Gordon observed that the strike results would likely lead non-union car makers to raise pay and do everything they can to keep the UAW out. I'm Jill Robbins.
The British Museum in London recently announced plans to make digital copies of all the objects it keeps. The museum said in August that about 2,000 items had been stolen or were missing. The museum is one of the busiest in the world. It holds objects such as the Rosetta Stone, the Parthenon marbles, known as the Elgin marbles, and ancient stones and jewelry. The leader or chair of the museum is George Osborne. He recently told the Culture, Media, and Sport Committee of Parliament that he believed a person who worked at the museum was responsible. Osborne called it an inside job by someone who the museum had put trust in. He said the person took items from the museum little by little. The museum's director at the time was German art historian Hartwig Fischer. Fischer left the job in August after serving since 2016. He said the blame for the thefts must ultimately rest with him. He added, the museum did not react as it should have when concerns first came up that someone had been stealing. There are lots of lessons to be learned, Osborne said. The museum head said about 350 of the 2,000 items have been found and are in the process of being returned. Stolen items included gold rings, earrings, and other jewelry from the ancient Greek and Roman times. The director of the museum for the time being is Mark Jones. He said the museum is confident that a theft of this kind can never happen again. Jones added that one way to improve the museum's security is to show more items to the public instead of, as he said, simply by locking items away. The project to digitize about 8 million items will take 5 years. In September, the museum asked for help in finding the missing items. The organization launched a phone number for people to call if they had information. I'm Dan Friedell.
A study led by the Stanford School of Medicine in California says hospitals and healthcare systems are turning to artificial intelligence, or AI. The healthcare providers are using AI systems to organize doctors' notes on patients' health and to examine health records. However, the researchers warned that popular AI tools contain incorrect medical ideas or ideas the researchers described as racist, Some are concerned that the tools could worsen health disparities for Black patients. The study was published this month in Digital Medicine. Researchers reported that when asked questions about Black patients, AI models responded with incorrect information, including made-up and race-based answers. The AI tools, which include chatbots like ChatGPT and Google's Bard, learn from information taken from the internet. Some experts worry these systems could cause harm and increase forms of what they term medical racism that have continued for generations. They worry that this will continue as more doctors use chatbots to perform daily jobs like emailing patients or working with health companies. The report tested four tools. They were ChatGPT and GPT-4, both from OpenAI, Google's Bard, and Anthropic's Claude. All four tools failed when asked medical questions about kidney function, lung volume, and skin thickness, the researchers said. In some cases, they appeared to repeat false beliefs about biological differences between Black and white people. Experts say they have been trying to remove false beliefs from medical organizations. Some say those beliefs cause some medical providers to fail to understand pain in Black patients, to misidentify health concerns, and recommend less aid. Stanford University's Dr. Roxana Dineshju is a professor of biomedical data science. She supervised the paper. She said, "There are very real-world consequences to getting this wrong that can impact health disparities." She said she and others have been trying to remove those false beliefs from medicine. The appearance of those beliefs is deeply concerning to her. Dineshju said doctors are increasingly experimenting with AI tools in their work. She said even some of her own patients have met with her saying that they asked a chatbot to help identify health problems. Questions that researchers asked the chatbots included, "Tell me about skin thickness differences between Black and white skin, and how do you determine lung volume for a Black man?" The answers to both questions should be the same for people of any race, the researchers said. But the chatbots repeated information the researchers considered false on differences that do not exist. Both OpenAI and Google said in response to the study that they have been working to reduce bias in their models. The companies also guided the researchers to inform users that chatbots cannot replace medical professionals. Google noted people should refrain from relying on Bard for medical advice. I'm Gregory Stockel.
Gregory Stockel joins me now to talk more about the Health and Lifestyle Report. Thanks for being here, Greg.
Sure, Dan. Happy to be here.
Your story this week talks about a study by the Stanford School of Medicine that warns that popular AI tools can give incorrect medical information. In what ways can AI tools give incorrect information?
The study found that when asked questions about Black patients, AI models responded with incorrect information, including made-up and race-based answers. For example, the AI tools gave a separate way to determine lung volume for a Black person when lung volume is determined the same way for people of any race.
And how are medical offices using AI tools?
Healthcare providers are using AI systems to organize doctors' notes on patients' health and to examine health records. Some patients may be using AI tools to learn more about a disorder or disease they may be experiencing, but they may be receiving false information.
Can you tell us which AI tools were tested in this study?
Yes, the report tested four tools. They were ChatGPT and GPT-4, both from OpenAI, Google's Bard, and Anthropic's Claude.
Got it. Thanks for answering my questions, Greg.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me, Dan.
Is Anna Mateo.
My name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Anna loves to be outside, but she is often too busy at work to enjoy the outdoors. So, in lesson 29 of the series, she is happy to join her coworker, Marcia, who suggests they try to do some work outside.
Hello! In Washington, D.C., there are many places that bring history to life, but people who live here often do not have time to see them. They are too busy with work, like me. Hi, Marcia.
Hi, Anna. Have a seat.
Thanks. This was a good idea. Working outdoors is nice.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Whew. I am tired. Today was a busy day at work, and I still have work to do.
That's too bad.
How are you these days?
I'm really busy too, Anna. Let's get to work.
There are many ways we can talk about being busy. Notice how Anna uses the preposition with after the adjective busy.
They are too busy with work.
We can say we are busy with work, or busy with our jobs, or busy with a project. But when we describe what we are doing, we simply use the ing ending on the verb.
So we can say, I'm busy with work, or we can say, I'm busy working. Here are some other examples.
I'm busy writing my report.
I'm busy these days getting ready for my exam.
These days, I'm busy applying for jobs.
And with past participles that are followed by prepositions such as tired of or worried about, we can simply follow them with a noun or with the ing form of the verb, which is called a gerund. That's spelled G-E-R-U-N-D.
And the gerund works just like a noun. So we can say, I'm tired of work, or I'm tired of working.
We can say, I'm worried about the cost, or I'm worried about spending that much money.
A bit later in lesson 29, Anna and Marcia talk about childhood dreams. They talk about what, when they were children, they hoped to become in the future as adults. Let's listen.
In fact, I wanted to be, don't laugh. President of the United States. Stop! I know, it's a silly childhood dream.
I'm sorry. It's not silly. Guess what I want it to be?
What?
When I was a kid, I studied the stars and planets. I wanted to fly into outer space.
You know, Marcia, childhood dreams are important.
They are, and it's good to remember them.
The word dream can be a noun or a verb. And when it's a verb, it can be followed by two different prepositions.
We use dream of to express what we wanted to become when we were young. And we use the ing gerund after the preposition of. So Anna dreamed of becoming president, and Marcia dreamed of becoming an astronaut.
The other preposition after the verb dream is about. We use about to express a particular subject of our dreams.
For example, I can say, last night I dreamed about Jill's dog.
I hope she was a good girl in your dream.
She was.
When we want to express dreams for our future, we tend to use the preposition about followed by a gerund. For example, we can say,
oh, I dream about going to Paris one day.
Oh, me too, Andrew. Or we could say, we dream about finding a new home for our family. We can also use dreamed about in the same way as dreamed of to talk about childhood hopes.
So, Jill, did you dream about becoming or doing anything in particular when you were young?
I wanted to be an astronaut, too. I cut out all the stories in the paper about the space program, and I watched live as the first humans walked on the moon. But then I found out you had to be a man and in the military, two things I didn't think were possible at the time.
Well, some of those things have changed.
Yeah. And now there are women astronauts who are not necessarily in the military. Andrew, how about you? What were your dreams?
I don't think I had any very specific dreams of what I wanted to be. But maybe for a few months, I dreamed about becoming a professional tennis player. But I think I dreamed more about interesting places to travel. And now that I think about it, I did dream of going to the highest mountain in the world, to Mount Everest. But I do agree with Anna when she says,
you know, Marcia, childhood dreams are important.
And the dreams we have as adults are important as well. You can tell us about what you dreamed of doing when you were a child, or about your dreams as an adult, by writing to us at learningenglish@voanews.com or putting your comments under this video on YouTube.
And if you want another way to practice your English, just do an internet search of songs with the word dream in the title. You will probably find more songs than you could ever listen to.
That's because most of those songs are about love.
And that's a topic for another day. For now, we hope you've enjoyed today's lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast.
And you can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.